The following is a program of the Santa Barbara County Education Office. To learn more, visit sbceo.org.
Hi, I'm Susan Salcido, Santa Barbara County Superintendent of Schools, and I am delighted to introduce my guest today, Mandy DeWitt, our 2019 Santa Barbara County Teacher of the Year, science teacher and science department chair at Carpinteria High School. Mandy, thank you so much for being here and welcome.
Of course, thanks for having me.
Can't wait to talk all about this Santa Barbara County Teacher of the Year recognition, also your classroom and teaching and instruction. But before we get into all of that, let's rewind and start off with your childhood, where you were born, raised, brought up. Let's learn more about Mandy as a little girl.
Sure. Well, I was born in Glendale in Los Angeles and lived in Burbank for the beginning part of my life. And my parents are from Burbank. They went to Burbank High School and are high school sweethearts even. Oh. So it was a big decision. When I was in third grade, my dad got a promotion that relocated us up to the Bay Area. Mm. So all of my extended relatives live in LA area, but we moved to the Bay Area to a small town called Benicia, which most people have not heard of. It's on the Northeast Bay, about 35 minutes driving from San Francisco. But it was a small town, about 27,000 people, very family-oriented, lots of parks and recreation and things like that. And for the most part, I really enjoyed it there. We played lots of sports growing up. I played both softball and water polo. My younger sister played softball as well and actually made her way all the way through college and won the Women's World College Series and is a coach now at Northwestern. Mm-hmm. And so she lives in Chicago. I live here because when I was 17, senior in high school, got into UC Santa Barbara and visited it once and knew that's where I wanted to come, and super lucky that I'm still here.
That's great. Yeah. And your folks are still in the Bay Area then?
Yes.
With lots of family down in Los Angeles.
Yeah, area. They're still in my house that I lived in growing up in Benicia and visit, you know, Christmas, Thanksgiving, holidays, and things like that.
I understand from your description of the place that you grew up after third grade that it sort of is like Carpinteria where you live now.
It is. Yeah. It's only one middle school, one high school, and a little bit bigger than Carpinteria where I teach at Carpinteria High School. Mm-hmm. You know, we only have about 600 students. Where I went to school, there was still about 1,600, but still that small town mentality. And so that's one of the things I really enjoy about working in Carpinteria is that small town vibe that you get.
Yeah, lots of family, community.
Absolutely.
School focus, for
yes,
sure.
Yes, big school focus and focus on the students and children that live there, which I love.
Yeah. So you talked about being 17, being accepted to UC Santa Barbara, yeah. And tell us how you selected your major, what inspired you to choose it. Let's talk a little bit about that.
Sure. Well, I've always loved science, as long as I can remember, to be honest. I loved doing little science experiments that I would make up by myself when I was little, and my favorite birthday presents were those funny ones where you could mix things together, and I would always be outside exploring. And so once it was time to apply for college, it was just kind of a matter of picking which one was my favorite, because I liked all of the sciences. And in high school, my favorite teacher taught chemistry. My favorite course was chemistry, and so that's what I picked at the time, just because I'd had such a great experience in that class. But then once I got to UC Santa Barbara, I realized I really like learning about living things, not just chemicals. And so I changed my major from chemistry to microbiology with the intention of possibly going to med school. So I took lots of really cool classes about bacteria and viruses and genetics. So that's kind of my niche. That's the stuff that I love is health-related bio.
Health-related bio. Yeah. I was just reflecting for a minute on what you said in terms of lots of cool classes on, what did you say?
On bacteria.
Yeah. But I thought, not many people would say this.
Yeah, how and why they make you sick. It's
right.
Fascinating.
It's fascinating.
To me.
I love
bacterial pathogenesis.
I love it. Yeah. I love that you love it. That's wonderful. So at some point, you decided you wanted to be a teacher. And was that while you were at UC Santa Barbara? And how did, and if so, how did you come to that decision that, yes, I want to be a teacher?
I was very lucky that I did happen to figure it out within my 4 years of being at UC Santa Barbara, but it was kind of at the tail end. Mm-hmm. The summer before my senior year, I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. I had done some volunteering and I'd worked in a job at Cottage Hospital to realize that I didn't really like the hospital atmosphere as much as I liked. I'd worked for the California Department of Public Health in their viral and rickettsial disease lab, which was really neat also, and it was right when West Nile was out with that big outbreak. Mm-hmm. But I didn't really feel like I got to interact with people enough, and so I got this email from the bio listserv saying, need 2 units, take this science and education course. And I knew I still wanted to do something with science. I'd obviously been studying it and I really enjoyed it. And I kind of thought back to all the times that I'd taught growing up. I was teaching swim lessons at the Wendy Faraday Swim School here in town at the time. I'd taught swim lessons in high school. I was a tutor. I said, you know, that sounds like fun. I'll sign up for this class. And within 3 weeks, I knew. It was once a week, but then they placed us out in local middle and high schools in the area. So I was at Dos Plebos twice a week for 3 periods a day, chemistry, biology, and AVID. And I just loved it. And I luckily had a great professor who also noticed how much I was enjoying it and pulled me aside after, I think, about the 3 week mark and said, have you thought about becoming a teacher? And I said, I have, but, you know, I don't know. And my parents kind of want me to be a doctor or something like that, so I'm not really sure. And she's like, no, I think you need to be a teacher. We have this teacher education program here at UCSB, and it's phenomenal, and I can help you sign up. And I said, oh, well, how does that work? She said, well, the applications are due in 6 weeks. You have to take the CBES, the CSET, this course about American democracy, but we can do it. And she really did. She held my hand the whole way and was such a mentor then, and she's still my mentor now. And so very thankful for that.
That's great. I love that story, all of it. Yeah. And I want to ask about the internship that you had at the hospital versus your experience in the classroom, because it seems like what's so fortunate is that you had the opportunity to go into a hospital and or into any other setting to think that's not necessarily what I want to do. You know, it's a real fortunate thing to be able to know what you don't want sometimes, you know.
Absolutely.
And then the difference between 3 weeks in and you knew that's exactly what I wanted. What do you think it was? What's the big difference? Was it simply working with students, or was it beyond that?
It was beyond that, but it was definitely that human connection. Mm-hmm. Because when I was working at the hospital, it was a neat time. They had college students on site. For the first time, they transitioned from paper to medical records that were digital on the computer. So I was trained in how to enter those records, and they'd station us at different parts of the hospital. And I kept getting stuck on ICU, which was really hard for me. I didn't realize, you know, these are people that they come into your life, you're treating them for that moment, and you're learning their families, and then they pass on, and you're with them at that end piece, but it's so hard and it's so fragile and you don't really get to know them, and it's very tragic. And I realized at that moment that I want to really get to know people, and as important as healthcare is, I would go home and I would feel unsatisfied and I'd feel sad. And that's when I knew that it wasn't quite the outlet for me. I didn't write it off completely, because obviously you don't have to work in a hospital. You could be a primary care physician or something, do research. But I was really, it wasn't filling to me the same way as when I was in the classroom and I was with students, and there's so much happening and every single day is different because you're learning a different concept each time, and students are funny and they're silly, and you know, just that learning and that energy from the teenagers in the room, it was just such a difference. And I would look forward to going there again and seeing the teacher and seeing all the same students. And I got to do that for that 10-week quarter. And I thought, like, wow, I only go twice a week for 10 weeks. Like, what would it be like if I was in the classroom with students for a whole year?
So, that's great. Yeah. Thanks for sharing that. And by the way, I think viewers who are thinking about signing up to be a teacher have just signed up, because you've probably very motivated them to and all of the reasons why. Yeah. One thing that I heard you say in an acceptance remarks as Teacher of the Year, which we'll go into in a minute, but something that I remember hearing you say was around the fact that you're a teacher of students, you know, that, and it's really around, yes, it's a love of science, but it's really teaching students. and that connectivity that you have and the relationship building is so important to you, and I know is a part of your everyday in terms of your teaching. So I wanted to connect that because I think what mattered to you then obviously still matters to you now. And in terms of the love of science, I want to get a peek into that window, because the love that you have is something that I know you push forward into your classroom. What about science just really makes you hum and say, yes, this is what I love? And I've heard you say about science, it has to do with creativity. Mm-hmm. It has to do with more than black and white.
Absolutely.
Can you say more about that?
So kind of the definition that I like to use for science is evidence-based explanation. Mm-hmm. So we have all these amazing things around the world and in outer space that as humans we've been wondering about forever. And then we gather this careful evidence, and we have to be really creative in the way that we think of how to set up these experiments to gather this evidence. And we have all these conversations with other scientists to then figure these things out. And then years later, new technology might come along, and we realize that our explanation was completely wrong, and we throw it out the window. And that takes a lot of vulnerability to be able to say, I was wrong. You know, what I thought was the explanation is no longer true. But now we have this new evidence, and we're going to work with that and move forward. And so it's really like this journey. It's always changing. It's always trying to better our understanding of the natural world around us. And I think that too often in education with science, it's kind of this laundry list of facts that we have to learn that former scientists have learned. Mm-hmm. And of course, that's important. You need foundational knowledge in order to access the curriculum. But what science truly is trying to make those explanations, figuring out the way to gather the evidence you need, then getting with other scientists and putting together this big puzzle to then make this explanation. And so I just love it.
We can tell. We can definitely tell. Yeah. And I love that what you're saying is that it's so dynamic and ever-changing.
Absolutely.
And it's a process. And
yes.
So it's not something that somebody might think, well, it's a subject that stays stagnant.
Right.
It's really ever-changing. And I think that's something that fascinates you.
Yeah.
And clearly that you instill in the students in your class. Mm-hmm. So let's go back a little bit now. So we know we went to UCSB. We know what you studied and why.
Yeah.
But where did you teach? Because you've had several different teaching assignments up until being at Carpinteria High School. So let's just trace that path.
Yeah. So for the first 6 years of my career, I worked for Ventura Unified School District, and I was actually very fortunate to get a teaching position, because when I was graduating from the teacher education program was when we had the historic budget crisis and layoffs. And so when I got the phone call from Buena High School, like, hey, can you come in tomorrow for an interview? I was so thankful because I really wanted to stay in Santa Barbara. I love the community. My husband, who is my boyfriend at the time, mm-hmm. his whole family is here. And so, yeah, I worked at Buena High School for 3.5 years, and I taught 9th grade college prep biology and SADAI biology there. For those who aren't familiar with SADAI, it's a class targeted for English learners. And I loved it. It was hard. I had to commute. Luckily, I had a friend who also lived in Santa Barbara and went through the teacher education program with me, got hired at the middle school across the street. And so we carpooled for our first 2 years of teaching, which was amazing, because anyone who is a teacher knows that first year is very challenging, because there's so many things that happen that you don't expect,
right.
You're not prepared for, and making new curriculum. And so we, it was very therapeutic, our car rides back and forth from Ventura to Santa Barbara. So I worked at Buena for 3.5 years and had a very good relationship with the assistant principal there, who was a former middle school science teacher. And she moved on to become the principal at one of the elementary schools in Ventura, which then received a big magnet grant to turn it into a school of environmental science. And so she reached out to me during my 4th year at Buena and said, hey, can you come work at the elementary school? I said, what are you talking about? I'm a high school teacher, and I'd just become science department chair at Buena. We had just debuted these brand new standards. I was really excited. She said, I think this would be a really valuable experience for you, and I know you can help transform this school. So for 2.5 years, I was the K-5 science specialist at Will Rogers Elementary School, helping them transition into a school of environmental science, which was an incredibly valuable experience for me to learn what it really is like to teach K through 5, because it's very different than high school. There's a lot of things that are the same and a lot of things that are different. I found my love of working with teachers through that position, but I also found out that I didn't want to go into administration through that position because it was a very administrative position, and the days that I wasn't around students, I would go home sad. Mm-hmm. And it reminded me of way back when I realized I wanted to become a teacher that I love being around students and they rejuvenate me and they energize me. And so that was a very valuable experience. And so once that job was ending, since it was grant funded, I was supposed to go back into my classroom at Buena, but a teacher I knew at the middle school in Carpinteria said, "Hey, the biology teacher that's been teaching at the high school for almost 30 years is retiring. Mm-hmm. You should apply." And so that's how I end up in Carpinteria. And I'm so thankful that my path led me there. I'm very happy there.
It's wonderful. That is wonderful. Yeah. I love the story, too, because, again, you found out what you didn't want to do.
Absolutely.
You know, and you figured out what you do love to do. Mm-hmm. And also, I think it's super unique to have a perspective as a high school teacher of K through
Absolutely.
All the way up to 8 even. Mm-hmm. You know, it really is a different, rich learning, I think. Professional development that not everybody gets to have, you know, as a high school teacher to have that. It's really, really incredible background and experience.
Absolutely. I feel like I'm so much better of a high school teacher, actually, because I spent time in elementary school classrooms and because I spent time out of the classroom, and I kind of know how the districts work from a bigger perspective.
Right.
I am very fortunate, and even though I learned through that job that it wasn't for me, I'm so glad that I took that job. And that's actually something I would encourage teachers to do if that opportunity arises, to maybe take 1 or 2 years out of the classroom to be a teacher on special assignment or what have you. It was such a valuable experience for me, and I know I'm a better teacher because of it.
That's great. That's really great. Mm-hmm. So now you are department chair.
Yes.
At what is that like? What is that role for those who might not know what a department chair might do at Carpinteria High School?
Absolutely. So the biggest thing I think of is that we're kind of that communication piece between the rest of our department and the administration. Mm-hmm. And some of my jobs include making sure that we have everything we need for the science department, which is actually a pretty big job because we always need supplies because we're always doing awesome experiments and labs. And so I meet with all the teachers and see what labs that they're doing and what chemicals we might need and supplies we might need. And so I'm in charge of ordering those and keeping that organized. I also attend department chair meetings. Mm-hmm. So the history department, English department, you know, everyone gets together with the administration, just the one person. We have a conversation, they tell us things that then the following week we meet with just our department. So it's kind of a better way of communicating, so not everyone is, you know, all over the place. And then a huge part is mentorship. Mm-hmm. And it's very exciting. I have a lot of new teachers in my department. And even though I've been teaching for 8 years, it's only going into my third year at Carpinteria High School. So it's kind of a neat opportunity to be department chair, being so new to the school, but also having some veteran experience in the classroom and things, really guiding those teachers and helping them through their first few years and giving them curriculum and lab ideas and things like that.
That's great. It's wonderful to have that such great energy coming from the department chair and supporting all of the teachers in your department. Okay, Mandy, let's talk about this wonderful, incredible, prestigious honor of 2019 Santa Barbara County Teacher of the Year. Yeah. Can you tell us, where were you when you heard that you were selected? Walk us through that moment, because I just, what was it like?
It's actually such a funny moment, and I have it on video.
Do you?
Yeah, it's pretty funny. So it was the same day that the selection committee had come to observe me teach and interviewed, and Steve Keithley said, "Hey, you know, we should know by the end of the day. Mm-hmm. So when's a good time to call you?" I said, "Well, I teach this exercise class after school in the cafeteria, but I'll be done by 4:15 if you want to give me a call." So then for the rest of the day, when my students ask me, like, "Hey, when do you get to find out?" I'm like, "They're supposed to call me after school, after my exercise class." So they're, "Okay, let us know." And sure enough, I was walking, you know, sweaty in my exercise gear from across the quad with all my equipment and stuff. And these two girls who are in my freshman biology class come out of the library from our after-school program. Like, "Have they called you yet?" I'm like, "Not yet." And my phone literally started ringing, and it was an 805 number. And I goes, "I think it's them. I think it's them." And so I answer the phone, and, you know, he starts telling me, like, "Okay, well, we had 5 really good finalists. And I'm like, oh, I didn't win. He's like, so I just really wanted to call you and let you know that you are the 2000. And I just started jumping and screaming up and down. And it's so funny because my students were filming the entire thing. And I'm jumping around and I'm crying and they run over and they're hugging me. And it was really, I don't think I heard half of what he said until he said, so here's the hard part. You're not allowed to tell anyone. Oh. We're going to embargo this information until May 3rd when we have the school board. And I'm like, oh, no. Like, I don't know if this is being recorded or if this is going straight to Snapchat right now. And so then I'm like shushing them in the video, like, you know. I'm like, okay, well, can I tell my students? He's like, you know, students are pretty good at posting things on social media, so make sure you don't tell any students. I'm like, so anyways, it was a really special moment. And as soon as I got a phone, I was like, so turns out I'm not allowed to tell anyone. So you guys are going to have to really keep this a secret. And I'd love that video. And when it's announced, I'll put the video up. And they were really good. They didn't tell anyone.
Aww.
But there's a few other people wandering around kind of looking and staring. So there was a few people that knew. But it was really exciting. And yeah, I did post that video and the kids were all mad. They're like, how come you didn't tell us? I was like, I wasn't allowed to. We would have kept it a secret. I'm like,
So. Well, great, good job on the couple students who did
yes,
see it and
yeah.
they kept that secret.
They did a good job.
Yes, yeah. That's great. I love that you shared that moment because, mm-hmm. You know, obviously it really impacted you for not just that moment, but for now, for forever, really, you know,
yeah.
to have this, the highest honor, really, of a teacher in the county, which comes with a high responsibility as well, as you well know. And you're being selected a 2019 or any year Teacher of the Year, you're really representing the voice of all of our excellent teachers in the county. So as you think about that responsibility and as you have thought about it, how do you anticipate or expect or want to use your position as County Teacher of the Year to spread the word around the importance of education or what is important about education?
I think accepting opportunities such as this mm-hmm. to kind of be in the public eye, and I'm thankful I'm actually going to be a keynote speaker at the American Association of University Women in the spring.
Wonderful.
And speaking to the importance of STEM and education and and empowering young girls. And so I think these opportunities, as they arise, I'm really excited to take them and just really communicate a lot of the messages that I shared within my application, that student relationships are key. Mm-hmm. And one of the most important ways that we can make relationships with our students is if we have class sizes that are reasonable. And I know that's out of the hands of teachers, but if we make sure that we are paying attention and we're having these conversations about reasonable class sizes, that we can, you know, work together to make that happen and vote for people who know the importance of class size, because there's such a huge difference when you have 40 students in front of you, as I often did at the beginning of my teaching career when we were going through the teacher crisis of pink slips and things like that, mm-hmm. versus now I'm very fortunate that I have about 25 students in front of me, and that it's critical. I have so much more time that I can spend with each individual student, just little things that I can ask them when I walk by their desk, you know, that I wouldn't necessarily would have been able to do before, and the connections that you can make, knowing who's related to who plays what sport, mm-hmm. who splits time between mom and dad's house, who lives with their grandma, who has to walk to school, and things like that are really important because it gives you a perspective of the whole child and not just that 50 minutes where you're trying to, you know, cram standards.
Right.
It's so much more important to forge those relationships and then the learning comes naturally.
Yeah. So lots of public speaking engagement sounds mm-hmm. like supporting science and STEM mm-hmm. for all and girls
yes.
and young women,
mm-hmm.
which is fantastic,
yeah.
and a platform of really individualization of education,
yes.
and that
mm-hmm.
could be in the form of smaller class sizes
mm-hmm.
or at least opportunities to get individual understanding of students and how to support them. It sounds
mm-hmm.
like those are really important platforms upon which you are
yeah.
behind and will definitely support during your tenure as Teacher of the Year.
Mm-hmm.
Something I wanted to ask you about is something that I know you're very, very passionate about, which is empowering your students in
mm-hmm.
every day in your classroom and around learning.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean to you when you say, you know, I really want to empower students? Like, what does that look like?
Well, I think it's very important to know that all students can learn. Mm-hmm. And so if you go into the classroom each day with that belief, that knowing that every single student is capable of learning and showing what they know, then the rest, you know that they can learn, and so the rest becomes, how do I help them learn? Mm-hmm. And what can I do to make sure that they know that they can learn? And so I really like to have a laid-back atmosphere in my classroom that is a mix of routine, so they know what to expect, but then kind of a little bit of the unexpected each day. And so I start off each day with, you know, our objective, so that they know exactly by the end of the 50-minute class period what they should have gotten out of that day's lesson. And then I do check homework, and even if I don't have homework, I walk by every single student desk while they do a warm-up. That's kind of review questions, so I can check in with each of them. And if they're not understanding something, that's a lower, you know, affective filter that I can check in with them on a one-on-one basis, explain something to them real quickly, and check in with them and let them know, yes, I think you can do it, and, oh, yes, ask me about this, and it's okay. Mm-hmm. And so then after that, we do a lot of group activities, a lot of lab assignments, lots of research using the technology, and through it all, they see me being silly. They see me being vulnerable. Sometimes they ask me questions and I have no idea what the answer is. And instead of making it up, I say, I don't know. That's a great question for the wonder wall. So I have a wall in my classroom I call the wonder wall. It's just kind of funny. It's like they're too young. They don't get the connection to the old song sometimes. But they can put a question on a post-it note and their name and class period and park it up there. And then anyone from any class period, which is neat because I teach freshmen through seniors mm-hmm. in three different courses, anyone can pull the post-it, make a research little poster about it just on regular paper and answer that question. That's and neat. They just have to present it really quickly to the class, and then I hang it up on the wall with the question being answered. And so at this point in time, I didn't take it down after last year. There's like 36 different posters. I was running out of room because they had so many questions, and they know that they can research them, and it's all a learning process that we're all learning together. So I'm not just this person who knows everything. I wasn't born knowing everything. There's still plenty of things I don't know. And so empowering them, like, yeah, we can figure it out together, and you do have something to bring to the table, and I'm silly, and I run into things, and I don't always know the answer, and it's okay if you don't know the answer or if you make a mistake, too. So
I love that. I love that example of empowering students in so many different ways. In so many different ways. It's really great. And I know that you also support teachers. You were just a lead teacher in SCRIP, which is, can you explain what SCRIP is at UC Santa Barbara real briefly for us?
Yes. It's actually South Coast Science Project, mm-hmm. so it's SESP. But South Coast Science Project is actually a regional branch of the California Science Project, mm-hmm. which gets its funding from the Subject Matter Project. And so it's grant-funded. The money's just housed through UCSB, mm-hmm. and I am co-director there with Darby Feldwin in the chemistry department. And what we do is two branches, and the branch I work with is our annual summer institute, where we invite about 40 teachers from the Ventura, Santa Barbara, and surrounding areas that teach elementary school. So mm-hmm. in our area, that's usually K through 6. And each summer, the content rotates. So this summer was Earth and Space Science. And the goal is to teach content and hands-on lessons and strategies they can bring right back into their classroom.
That's great.
So it's a lot of fun because we do the science as if they're students. And so I guided them through a first grade lesson last week where we were outside looking at shadows at different times of the day. So we had chalk and we were tracing our shadows and then bringing that back into the classroom and analyzing it. But then we also have guest speakers who come and speak to us about black holes and things like that for our own knowledge.
Right.
And so it's a mix of personal science knowledge mixed with really fun activities that are standards-based that they can bring back into the classroom.
I love that. You were talking earlier about empowering students, but that really helps empower teachers as they go back with their students.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Well, Mandy, I can't believe our time is already up. It just goes by so fast when you talk with the County Teacher of the Year. And truly an honor to talk with you and learn from you and be inspired by you. Truly, I wish you and all of your students a wonderful year, and thank you for your inspiration. Thank you for serving as County Teacher of the Year, and thank you for your time today.
Thank you. It's such an honor.
I'm Susan Salcido, Santa Barbara County Superintendent of Schools. Thank you so much for joining us today for this edition of Talking with Teachers.